lawsuit. Welcome, friends and future colleagues, to a new and reinvented Lawgers. You have come to the most interesting legal platform for talk shows and more. We give you candid talks with people who you look up to. I'm Muskan Narang, your host for today. I'm a second year law student from D.Y. Patil University. And we have with us today Advocate Aastha Chadha ma'am. She is a third generation lawyer with an excellent and in-depth experience of working in various chambers, law firms in and around Delhi. She deals in various legal matters and is currently impaneled in leading companies and institutions. I am so glad to have you on my show, ma'am. Thank you so much for coming today.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Ma'am, actually, I would like to tell my viewers here that we connected a long time back on LinkedIn, and ma'am was so kind enough to reply to me and actually come on the show today.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting.
Thank you so much, ma'am. So, ma'am, I usually start with the question that why did you decide to choose law, and why was law something that attracted you?
So, law was never a planned decision. I was always attracted to it since childhood, because the environment in my home was like that. You know, there were even the jokes we crack at home have a slight legal touch to it. There is.
Okay.
With jurisdiction and limitation period and everything. Even if I ask my father for some small little thing, he'll crack something like that.
Okay.
So, and my entire family, even if they are not practicing lawyers, they have law degrees.
Right.
So, that is the reason my family was not interested in me becoming a lawyer. And not, as a kid, I was a very, very sweet, very, very, very sweet kid. So my mother tells me that when they got my horoscope checked, so the reader said, the Panditji said that iski vaad vivaad ki padhai ho.
Okay.
You know, that's right. And the entire family thought such a sweet kid ho hi nahi sakta. So they always thought ho hi nahi sakta. That is when I was very young. Then I grew up. And the interest was always there. Especially family law interested me. I had like, it drew me towards it. Then when I was growing up, half my family wanted me to become a doctor. And half my family wanted me to become a CA. So that was for sure. Then I finally took commerce. And I gave the CA entrance. And to everybody's delight, first attempt, I cleared the entrance.
Okay, wow.
And I joined BCom and I did CA.
Okay.
But the thing that happened was we have law as a subject in both BCom and CA. And I feel more and more in love with the subject.
Right.
So it was like I used to, the entire commerce was on one side and my love for law was on the other.
Right.
Then after, I think in the second year or something, I told my family, this is not happening. Second year of BCom. I told them, this is not happening. If you want me to complete my CA, I will complete it. But I am doing law. And at that time, CA law was hardly, I think it was disappearing slowly.
Okay.
But then, normal 5-year law was the thing.
Right.
And finally, I fought and I was like on a rebellion altogether. I told them I am doing law and that is what I want to do. Finally, I know what I love.
Right.
So that is how me being from the family of lawyers went to do law. So then what happened? Then that's another interesting story is, then I gave the first group of the IPCC CA, cleared it.
Okay.
I did not give the second group because I thought if I'll get the CA degree before the law degree, they'll force me to become a CA.
Okay.
So I had to, you know, I dropped it.
Right.
I dropped the degree because I thought law pehle aani chahiye, otherwise they will not let me do it.
Okay.
So then when I finally started doing law, then my dad said, if you're doing law, why not judiciary? Try for judiciary. So I was like, fine. If that is the way I'm getting it, I'll get it that way. Then I started studying for judiciary. And there I just explored law college and judiciary made me fall. Earlier, I was only exposed to the law of contracts and the commerce side of law. When I entered law school, I was like, there are so many varied fields I can specialize in.
Right.
And especially, family law was something I fell in love with.
Hmm.
I remember Hindu law was something I used to, you know, there is one subject where the teacher teaches you, and there's another subject where somewhere you give an answer to the teacher's like, I've never thought about it.
Wow. So okay.
Hindu law was that for me. It was love. It still is. Some of my friends, college friends, just call me, or some of my senior colleagues also just call me and say, wo succession mein kaun hota, matlab wo kya hota tha, ya something like that.
Wow, okay.
So I practice, that is why I still practice in a lot of things. Like I practice in civil and negotiable, but like matrimonial and succession and family is love.
Mm.
That is, nothing can take that from me. So that is the way my interest in law just keep on growing.
Mm.
And when I started preparing for judiciary, there are a lot of subjects that I studied that I didn't even study in law school.
Okay.
Right. And I started studying deeply. Mm-hmm. You know, you have to crack judiciary, you have to go in the depth of the subject.
Right.
There, my just love, I think, for law increased manyfold, exponentially.
Mm-hmm.
That is where it started growing. When I went into the depths of it. Because in law school, you know, we don't study for the academic exams.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have to write answers, long answers, and we pass.
Exactly. Also, it's all about cramming, and it's all about the 5 year is like a 5 year vacation for some students.
Nowhere a vacation for me. Nowhere. Because I was juggling. I had in first year of law college, I had joined a publishing house.
Okay.
As a freelancing editor. Okay. Because, you know, right, writing skills are something which a lawyer needs.
Right.
So I thought I'll get published also.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll improve on my writing skills also. So mm-hmm. I joined them as an editor, and then I wrote a few of their English books and edited their books. So I was managing that, and I was going for my judiciary coaching, and I was rushing back to college. It was nowhere a breeze for me. It was nowhere something, it was nowhere a vacation. Rather, I remember people telling me, we are not seeing you enough. I was like, I have a career to make.
Right.
I was really clear. My best friend till date tells me that you owe me those years where you have not talked to me properly and not telling me that.
Right.
Wow. Poor fellow still has that problem. I still don't get enough time.
So how did you exactly spend time in college? How were you as a law student?
I think I was very studious.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not somebody who studies for the exam.
Okay.
If you study for the exam, then it's all about being the topper.
Right.
For me, it's never about being the topper. For me, it was always about knowing the subject inside out.
Hmm.
Like I was that student, you know, that person who goes in class, stares at the teacher and nods. Keeps on nodding.
Right.
Yeah, that person who maintains that eye contact with the professor and keeps on nodding. And the professor is like, this is the only child in class that is listening to me.
Right, exactly.
I was that student.
Mm.
Rather, I had improved considerably by the time I reached law college.
Okay.
In school, I was terrible. In school, I was that kid who reminds the teacher that you had asked for a test today.
Okay.
was that
right. That is so cute.
Yeah, I'm ashamed, but I was.
Right. So, but ma'am, what time did you get fascinated by family law or some subject that you really like, that you really wanted to pursue it? And also that, okay. why family law and why things like Succession Act or, matrimonial disputes?
I'll tell you why. First of all, when I got attracted, I think even before starting law college, you know, that time when you're preparing for your entrance exams and you read for the CLAT and everything and you read books. So mm-hmm. one thing that attracted me a lot was the adultery law.
Mm.
Right. The adultery law was something which caught my attention even before I managed to enter the law school. Mm. And in that, I remember writing a small note.
Mm-hmm.
I was reading about it and it fascinated me. And I had written a few things. I had written things like, it's an offense by a man against a man.
Mm.
It's an offense where a woman has no autonomy over herself. So I had a few problems with the law.
Mm.
And I remember, and I had written about it and I wanted to publish it.
Mm-hmm.
And my father said, one, you're too young. And two, I want you to prepare for judiciary, so I don't want you to sound like a biased judge.
Okay, right.
Right. I want you to have an opinion which is like well-informed and everything.
Mm.
And but when the Supreme Court judgment came, though a few points that I had written down were there in the judgment, observations of the court. And that day, I remember fighting with my father for 2 days that if I would have published it.
Right. Wow.
Then it would have been resonated with the judge.
Right.
So it started, right. So it started there.
Mm-hmm.
And then in first year itself, because I had started preparing for judiciary, so although LLB matrimonial laws were there in the second year, I had read it in the first year.
Okay.
And what resonated, I think, with me was the human emotions involved with it. You know, when you see civil law or when you see any property, TPA, SRA, there it is something which doesn't have human touch in it.
Right.
There are no emotions. It's like inanimate objects.
Right. Hmm.
And especially when you go to something like international law or administrative law, especially administrative law, Transfer of Property Act, then I never felt that connect.
Right, exactly.
I have always been somebody
that comes behind something, that story or something that holds it together is what humans are.
Yes, exactly. So that is why these acts have always fascinated me.
Right.
You know, that was when I was a student, when I had only books to refer to. But even now, when I sit with clients and the way I converse with them, someday they'll come to you, they'll be in a completely different mood because they are just recently, they are separated and their emotions. Then there'll be days when those clients will be extremely calm and then there'll be days when they'll be jubilant. So, I think that human connect is something that attracted me towards that law. And I think one more thing that attracted me is that since childhood, I've been a feminist.
Right.
Women rights are something I have been talking about since I think the term feminism was not there in India.
Right.
It was not a mainstream word when I was 10 years old or 12 years old.
Mm-hmm.
But I somehow realized that there was, I think as a child also, I somewhere realized that there was something wrong.
Hmm. Right.
I just didn't know as a child what was wrong.
Wow. Okay. Actually.
I didn't know what it was called. I just didn't know how to express it. I remember once in school, I was in primary section.
Mm-hmm.
And in school, there was a debate about working mothers. And I'm a working mother. I'm a working woman's daughter. Okay. Right.
Mm-hmm.
I was one of the very few children who said that what is the problem with a woman being working? Rather, we are more responsible children.
Right. So, exactly.
Right. So that, then once I won a debate about, there was something, I don't even remember properly, but there was something where I said that, okay, fine, the whole family goes for a vacation and every day everyone comes back tired and it's the mother who's making tea.
Right.
Observations I had,
mm-hmm.
but I just didn't know how to express them. There was no term called feminism. There's no term called women's rights.
Right.
So I was like, what? There's something which I feel, why doesn't everybody else feel like that?
Mm-hmm. Right.
That too, when I'm from a family where there is, I would say, all kinds of rights and equality.
Mm.
But I see it in the outside world.
Right.
So I think even that attracted me to these laws. Because these laws, even we say they are very progressive, but they still have flaws.
Exactly.
They have flaws. So I think that also attracted me.
Right. Also, ma'am, I think it's really the feminism part. It was really powerful that you said that when somebody is younger, they know something is wrong. Being a child, a female child, you know something is wrong, but you can't exactly pinpoint where it is wrong or what being done to you is wrong. So I think it's really fascinating that people do observe it. People are not able to say what it is, wrong.
Because now I see my 17-year-old cousin sister, she knows so many terms, and I love sitting with her because one, she's a sociology student.
Right.
So they know all the more terms.
Mm-hmm.
So she's very good for me. She keeps me updated on everything. And I think these kids these days, they know the terms, they know that what is problematic, they're more aware.
Right.
And I think they're more woke.
Right.
They know something not to be said. We didn't know some things are not to be said.
Right, exactly. Also, ma'am, when you stop yourself from saying things, when you stop yourself and think about what you're saying and how it is going to affect you and the other person and their psyche, that actually makes you a true feminist. Because then even as a feminist myself, if I stop myself from doing something or saying something, or like maybe somebody else is saying something and I'm stopping her from doing something, and then I think about it, that why am I stopping her? Why am I forming this opinion? When you stop yourself, you think about your thoughts and how you're putting them out in the world. That is what makes you a real feminist, I think.
I think what absolutely true. And I think what makes you a real feminist is also to keep on evolving your idea of feminism.
Right, right.
Now, sometimes I remember I come from a place where I'm very ambitious.
Mm-hmm.
I can't think of not having a career. I can't think of not being, at least not giving 10 to 12 hours a day to my work, or even thinking of retiring at the age of 60.
Mm-hmm.
So I've come from a place of judging people from making these choices that do not conform to this idea.
Right.
I always thought that. Now I have evolved to a level where I feel having a career may be a choice, not having a career may be a choice.
Mm-hmm.
So now normally what we say about feminism is we think that making good choices, self-centered choices, or maybe self-evolving choices,
mm-hmm,
towards your evolution as a person. We think that only that is maybe feminism.
Mm-hmm.
But it takes, I think, your idea of feminism, if it keeps on evolving, that is, I think, the true definition.
Right.
Because maybe we are doing now, 10 years from now, it is, if we don't evolve, we'll be problematic.
Right.
Or toxic as we
say.
Our idea may be toxic.
Mm-hmm. Also, it doesn't, with feminism, it gave me more respect for my mother, who's a housewife. Thinking about how she has chosen for herself that she can do anything else, but she wants to become a housewife with her own choice. And you're respecting that choice, thinking that, she gave value to whatever she was thinking and not what the society was making her do. That is something which is really, I'm proud of her. So, ma'am, since we talked about how your days look like, how you deal with clients and everything, so what is a typical day or in your life?
A pre-lockdown, post-lockdown?
Both.
So, pre-lockdown, my day varied. It started at around 7:30.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I used to get up, read the files for the day. If it was Rohini code, then I was out of the house by 8.
Right.
And then reach court. I have a very bad problem of reaching court at least 20 minutes early, because I hate being late.
Right.
I am that person who will be late for parties, but always before time for work.
Right.
So if it's Rohini code, then my day is gone. I have to leave home by 8, quarter to 8, 8, reach court. Then I think 2 o'clock, till 2 o'clock, I'm for sure in court.
Mm-hmm.
For sure. And then I'm back to office, read files for the next day, prepare. If there are client meetings, then evening I keep for client meetings. Then there are client meetings. Then, if there are arguments or cross-examination the next day, then there's no sleep.
Okay.
There's hardly any sleep because you have to prepare and then you have to research on the case laws. And then you have whatever your team has sent you, you have to accumulate that. And if you see if it works, you have to test. If there's arguments the next day, then your day is doomed.
Mm-hmm.
You are not sleeping that day. Or you're sleeping for only 3 days, 4 days, 3 hours, 4 hours.
Right.
So that's what an normal pre-lockdown day looked like.
Mm-hmm.
And not to forget, if you have morning in Saket court, maybe then a matter in Patiala, then you're rushing from one court to the other.
Mm-hmm.
And there have been times where in times when there are urgent bail matters, you had one date in one court and then you had to rush to the other and then somebody is waiting for you in the first one and you know that that judge is very very strict and your client can suffer.
Right.
So that was mad. That was something I can't even think of now, at least now that it is 8-9 months that we are living this peaceful life.
Right.
I know what it will feel like going back.
Mm-hmm.
So that was pre-lockdown. I had no time for friends. I had no time for family. Everybody was honestly always angry with me. My friends were always angry with me. My best friend has a problem. I think we've been friends for like 7-8 years now, first year of law school.
Okay.
And that person has always had a problem with me that I didn't have time for him then and even don't have it now. So that problem with me. And so that is the reason why pre-lockdown I had no life, no social life, no social media life.
Okay, right.
I was just in my office or in court.
Mm-hmm.
Then comes lockdown. For the first 15 days, I don't know what to do.
Right.
I was going crazy. And when I say crazy, for the first 5 days, I was going bad crazy.
Mm-hmm.
Because I thought, what will I do now?
Hmm.
For the first 5 days, I didn't know how to finish my day, how to spend my days. Because everything, your files are in the office, your books are in the office,
right.
Everything is in the office, and you don't know what to do. You're so used to not having a life. And then after five days, suddenly you start enjoying life because you realize you've not taken a leave since first year of law college, which is seven years back.
Right.
So you realize you've not taken a proper leave in 7 years.
Mm-hmm.
And then you start enjoying life. That is also a stage that happened. And then around when those 21 day lockdown was the first lockdown.
Right.
So after, for those 10-15 days now, you're enjoying life. You're like, now I'm not working. The clients who had something coming up, because at that time, people had suddenly started panicking.
Okay.
There was a lot of unrest was there. So people wanted to suddenly get their wills done. Even people of my age were getting their wills done.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So then suddenly when that work used to come, I used to do that work and being lazy, you know, sometimes you feel like raat ko kar denge because wo thoda sa aa chuka hai.
Mm-hmm.
And then the first lockdown got over, it got extended, then suddenly panic strikes you.
Hmm.
Then panic strikes you that this is extending.
Right.
then there was that state. That state was not a very good state because the courts were not functioning properly.
Mm-hmm.
And we were suddenly, all of us were a little panicked. And virtual courts were hardly there. And so that stage was not a very good stage. Mm-hmm. So what I did was, I arranged for things. I set my residence office. I equipped it fully. I equipped it for all this. Put extra, put a better connectivity, an extra internet service, arranged for everything. Because I understood that something is not right.
Mm-hmm.
This will extend. So then the post-lockdown day starts. Now the post-lockdown day doesn't start at 7:30. Because there's no traveling for 2 hours to the court.
Exactly, right.
Mm. That is a very good thing about it.
Mm.
It starts around 8:30, 9. And but by 9:30 I'm in my office, because by 10 I want to be properly working in for the courts. And if I have dates, then for the courts, virtual hearings, then there are client meetings are happening on Zoom. So earlier the client that used to sit in front of you now is on the screen. So the problem is sometimes you have to give them more time to compensate for the lack of emotional connect. Like I told you, our field is all about emotional connect. Right. So then there are around till 2, I don't keep anything. I don't keep much of meetings because I want to keep things for the court. Then 2 to around 6:30, I try to keep my meetings, finish them off. Then after 6:30, it's my file time. I have to prepare for the cases, file new cases, draft and everything. And nowadays, I get good night's sleep. Cross-examination is anyway not happening. Evidence is not happening on virtual courts. So that is a good thing. Then I think that is a good thing. I am relaxed. And yes, of course, there are. But now what I've compensated is, because I have extra time, I don't know how to kill it. So I'm there on social media. Time goes there. Finally, after I think 7-8 years, I'm on social media.
Okay.
I was never on social media. I didn't even have a Facebook account till I was, 20, 21.
Okay.
And after that, it was lying dormant for around 7-8 years. And finally, I had so I think my LinkedIn account also I opened the post lockdown.
I think so. I've seen you active only in the lockdown period.
So this is how my day looks like pre and post lockdown. The only difference I think is less travel and more social media and more talking to people.
Right.
And I think lockdown has been really good for me in two things. One, it has not made me less ambitious, but it has somewhere taught me that it's easy to relax. It's okay to relax. Okay. I always thought, you know, if I'm doing this, I'm wasting time. If I'm doing that, I'm wasting time. Because as lawyers, we're always buying time.
Right.
We're always taking our own time from one place or the other.
Right.
So it taught me that it's easy to go slow and it's easy to relax and sit back for a day or maybe.
Okay.
So one thing that is good. And second thing that happened was, I joined social media, and I started talking to more of my family and friends, because the time that you save in traveling, you can spend here. Now you're not necessarily traveling for 3-4 hours a day.
Right.
Traveling is bad. And
I think with ambition,
you have courts at such distances.
Right, exactly. Ma'am, I think with ambition also, there is a point that comes that you have this burnout moment that you, even if you're ambitious and you want to work harder, but that kind of time management, or if you keep working all the time, there is a burnout that happens and you cannot, like some people do not recover from that. So it's easy, like it's better to be consistent than actually cram everything in one day and then feel exhausted at the end of the day.
Yeah, but I think that burnout moment never happened for me for two reasons. One, I have been like this since the very childhood. So this is the way I work.
Okay.
It's not that I am working 24 hours. But it is, even if the 2 hours, 3 hours, I'm not working. I am thinking of a way where I can use those hours.
Right. Okay.
So I've been like this since the very childhood. Like I remember once somebody told me that if you've achieved something, sit for 2 minutes, enjoy that achievement. What you do, you start planning for the next goal. So once somebody told me, sit and enjoy, bask in your glory. So I've been like that since childhood. This is the way I am.
Right.
And second thing, the other good thing about me that happened was, one, I have a very tight-knit family. The family support is enormous.
Right.
Enormous. And secondly, I enjoy small little things. Although I have big dreams and ambitions, I am happy. Look, for example, I don't need to be happy on a vacation if I'm traveling, if I'm staying in a 7-star.
Okay.
I can be happy even maybe agar main wo kehte hai na journey mein aap jab sadak pe ruk ruk ke car travel mein sadak pe ruk ruk ke choti choti cheeze karte ho,
and vodka and all that.
Wo sadak ki chai.
Mm-hmm.
I'm happy with all that.
Right.
बर्नआउट पॉइंट नहीं आता, पता है? थर्डली आपका बर्नआउट पॉइंट इसलिए भी नहीं आता, बिकॉज़ यू लव व्हाट यू आर डूइंग.
राइट राइट, एंड दैट इज व्हाट एनर्जाइजेस यू टू वर्क इवन मोर.
यस, आई रिमेंबर व्हेन आई वाज फाइनली एंटरिंग प्रैक्टिस एंड आई वाज थिंकिंग शुड आई एंटर इनटू मे बी समथिंग रिलेटिंग टू आईटी और मे बी समथिंग एल्स इंटेलेक्चुअल प्रॉपर्टी व्हिच इज अ सनराइज सेक्टर. सो I remember, you know, sitting and thinking what to do. And it's not that we don't do such stuff. As lawyers, we have our niches, but then if we get some work and we collaborate and get it done with.
Right.
So we do other work also. But I remember my father sat me down and he told me to do what you love doing. He told me that if you enjoy this side, if you enjoy dealing with people, talking to them, then do that. Like I have been a debater since childhood. I was always on the stage.
Right.
Yeah, I was somebody who was there on the stage. I think since childhood I've been there.
Right.
I love speaking. That is good for my job. I love patrimonial law. That is good for my job. And I love reading. I love reading. So that is good for my job. So maybe somewhere, maybe I because I love what I'm doing. Maybe that is because there's no burnout.
Okay. Mom, do you, when we talk about the work environment and we talk about how a lawyer deals with another lawyer, like how is the lawyer community as per your experience? How have been they dealing with you or how do you deal with them?
So I think I have for till now in so many years, the little few years of experience that I have, I think we are a very close-knit community. I have not seen a community which is so close-knit. There have been times when I was a junior lawyer, I was working under somebody. So at that time, you know, you are doing the filing also, you are carrying the files also, you are arguing also. That time is a very tough time. Because so the one day I remember I had gone for some work and I had some paperwork in my hand and I had to have, I wanted stamps and I wanted tickets and I wanted small little things. And I remember I started asking people and somebody just gave me something and I told them, this is the amount, very, you know, I told the person, please take the money.
Right.
He was like, no, it's okay. And you know, somebody senior, okay? So like, sir, please. He was like, no, it's okay. So I was like, no, sir, please, because you know, in the first year, you want to do everything right. You have your, you know.
Right.
So then one thing he told me, which I stand by till day. He told me, today you needed it. I gave it to you. Do one thing. Don't return it to me. When somebody else needs it, just help that person, help that lawyer.
Yeah.
And he told me, beta, that is the way our community works.
Okay.
Agar hum lawyer se dusre ki help nahi karenge, to kaun karega?
Right. Wow.
It's something, I think it's a very close-knit community. I think it's a community where if I get a case, for example, now I get cases which are not in Delhi, which are somewhere in the other city. So I have two ways. And then I want local counsels, right? And there have been times when somebody was not able to do my work, that person told me, ma'am, go to so-and-so person, he's a good lawyer.
Okay.
So that person gave that person a work. I've seen they are very, very helping as a community. That is very good.
Right.
I love that thing about the community we are in. We are very helping towards each other. Of course, we have times when you are fresh in the field and then there'll be a senior advocate who's standing who will be the opposite counsel, mm-hmm. and that senior advocate will have ego issues and will want to put you down, and you have to argue to your best, because you know you have to prove it to the judge that I'm not, just because I'm doesn't mean I'm not worth it.
Right.
So yeah, you will have ego. You right. will have people who would snub you just because you are young.
Mm-hmm.
Not because you're less experienced or less knowledgeable. So that is a problem. That is also a problem that we have in a community, mm-hmm. that sometimes senior counsels try to snub you in court.
Right.
In front of the judge.
Mm-hmm.
Just because, not because you have a weaker argument, but because you're a counsel who is young.
Right, right. Ma'am, I think I found really surprising one day when I went to Dwarka court. I was there for some internship, and there was a hall of people where the lawyers were together and they were discussing something. And I entered the room and I was surprised to see there was not one female lawyer there in the whole hall. I saw all male lawyers there. Sorry?
That was my third point. That was exactly my third point. Mm-hmm. That one more thing I do not like about people, which is, I think, not something which is exclusive to the lawyer community.
Right.
It is worldwide. It's worldwide.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And that it is, and especially advocacy is predominantly a male-dominated area.
Right, right.
Once it happened with me, I was in the Delhi High Court and I was in the elevator. And in the elevator, there were around 5 male advocates and I was the 6th one, right?
Okay.
And I think there were 2 people, I think around 60 years.
Okay.
They were quite aged. They were around 60 years old and there were two or three young lawyers.
Mm-hmm.
And very casually, an old lawyer asked the young one, "Why do you keep a beard?"
Okay.
So, you know, what that young person replied, the advocate, he replied that, "Sir, client को ना अगर हम दाढ़ी रखने से हम थोड़े बड़े लगते हैं, तो client को ऐसा लगता है कि हम थोड़े experienced हैं." Which is okay if you for him to say, which till then it was completely fine.
Right.
So then the senior asked that, "What about ladies?" अब तो दाढ़ी रखते नहीं बड़ी लग सकती ना.
Right.
That is what he meant. So what about them? You know what the young person replied, and I think he had the audacity to say it.
Mm-hmm.
And that was, "Sir, unko wakalat se thodi matlab hai. Unko to sundar dikhne hai. Unko to sundar dikhne hai. And unko thodi matlab hai. Unko koi dhang se wakalat thodi karni hoti hai." So yeah, this, and I just saw the senior getting embarrassed and looking at me.
Right.
Senior realized, jabki we think that the young generation is woke. Right.
Right,
so
right.
The senior, that 60-year-old man realized what just happened.
Right.
And then I had that moment, you know, you can have 2 things at that moment. There are 2 reactions. One is just tell him what he just did.
Right.
And just give him that look that someday you'll face me in court and then you'll see who's the better lawyer.
Right, right.
I chose the later one. You know, I chose the latter one. I was like, I gave him that look that, "What you've done, dude, I just saw that.
Right.
I heard. And someday we'll be there in court.
Hmm.
And then you'll see what just happens."
Exactly, exactly. There can be no better answer to that, ma'am. There can be no better answer.
Especially a professional place, you know. And secondly, I had my item number was really close. I couldn't
bother less.
But I remember that senior getting highly embarrassed.
Right.
Right. And yeah, so that thing is there.
Right.
You will see, one more thing you'll see is there are, you go to Teesazari court.
Mm-hmm.
And you realize that female toilets are not proper.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
But there are very small little things like there not being a latch in the toilet. That somewhere shows you that, you know, they are not equipped.
Right, exactly.
Okay.
Yes,
it's not male.
you cannot expect people to be equal when you're not including them to things. You're not making things inclusive for them. You know, the environment itself, it shows that it's ready for women or not.
Yes. But luckily for me, I have faced really good lawyers, both men and women.
Right.
I remember there being times where I was new and I got stuck and I just went up to anybody, you know. Like I said, I like talking to people.
Right.
So lawyers talk to people. So I should go to them and just ask, sir, I'm stuck and, you know, I have this case and I'm stuck at this point and this is what the judge said. And you just get, there are times when you don't have the time to go back to office and check for yourself. There are times you have to respond, react.
Right.
So I used to just go to sir, so and so, yeah, ma'am, this is the problem. And they used to help me. They used to help me like anything. So I luckily have not faced anything like that. Apart from that one incident that I just told you, I have not faced any sexist issue.
Right.
My experience has been very, very good. And sometimes, you know, when I tell this to people, they're like, how can this happen? How can this happen? It is so prevalent.
Right.
But luckily, my experiences has been very good. My seniors have that I've got have been amazing seniors.
I think
my colleagues have been amazing colleagues. Amazing colleagues. And even the interns that I've had have been really good. So luckily, my journey has been smooth that way.
Right.
Where, you know, for somebody like me who's looking at everything and finding flaws even in the most equal scenarios, there are some families or some social settings where you will, a normal person will go and say, yaar, kitni achhi family hai. I can go and find the problem. this is patriarchy and I can see it and people are thinking this is respect. Or this equal treatment. And somebody like that with such sharp observations of such things has not faced.
Right. That's nice. I think it's hope. It gives hope to people and people like me who are going to come to practice. I think it gives me hope that I'm not going to be afraid of, you know, facing things like this. That I think I've heard many people on the show even saying that they've faced many things when it comes to sexism and when it comes to not feeling equal. One thing is that you are not equal. Let's say you're in a sports competition and your ability doesn't match the other person's ability. It's just that the feeling of being unequal, when you know you have the ability to rise, that is the, I think, the worst thing that can pull somebody down.
You know, one is not being equal. One is in some places being superior also. And still getting unequal opportunities.
Right, right. Wow. What a wonderful take, ma'am, actually.
The thing is, you have to understand there is a reason that if females form 50% of the population.
Right.
Almost 50% of the population.
Right.
And we know that the level of education, the percentage of females who are educated is way less than the percentage of males that get education.
Right.
But still, if we find that every state topper, every entrance exam topper is a female,
right?
Then somewhere they are somewhere superior or maybe more hardworking because we have a problem of proving ourselves.
Right, right.
Because somewhere every time a female gets an opportunity, it comes with an obligation. That I have to make this world better for the other females.
Right.
Okay. Maybe that is why even like we are talking today, it is becoming about this.
Right.
It is so much there.
Right, exactly, ma'am. So, ma'am, also you talked about social media. Because a lot of people who are thinking, as I have discussed with my seniors, hear that they tell me that social media actually doesn't help you convert clients. Like, it doesn't help you convert people to clients. If you are really on social media as a lawyer, it doesn't help you. Obviously, you're not supposed to be showing ads. Obviously, you're not supposed to be, you know, advertising your practice. But just that being online, showing people your face, it just like the term says, jo dikhta hai, wo bikta hai. So that how, if you have observed in your social media presence right now that actually converting people to client, is that possible?
Okay. So I'll start with why I joined social media.
Mm-hmm.
First of all, I didn't join thinking I'll get clients. I didn't join thinking that I'll be visible. I just joined because I had nothing else to do. Mm-hmm. And I was saving those 4 hours of travel and I had to do something with those 4 hours.
Right.
That was my agenda because mm-hmm. khali rehne ki aadat nahi thi. So I started with that and then I started enjoying it.
Mm-hmm.
Whenever I post something, or especially when I address people, look, I have always been addressing people, whether it be law colleges or whether it be one-on-one. When I'm talking to, I am that person who, if you'll come and ask me for advice,
mm-hmm.
if I can manage time, I will manage time.
Oh,
because I love spreading education. I love spreading awareness. I'm like, how can I help?
Right.
How can I help is a problem I have.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I joined because of that. And then I started enjoying it because I could talk more and more and more and more.
Right.
So that was a good thing. Then what happens is every time that I come on, suppose say a webinar. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm having a webinar. There'll be a few things which I want to talk about. Which I think are relevant for the topic.
Mm-hmm.
And there'll be few things which are completely, they come from the live audience there.
Right.
There are questions which I haven't thought will come.
Mm-hmm.
And there are huge number of those questions.
Right.
Like very recently, I had a webinar, I think on matrimonial issues.
Mm-hmm.
The problems you have in matrimonial litigation. And the question that it was filled with, mm-hmm. the live audience questions, were filled with only two things, LGBTQ couples,
okay,
and live-in relationships, which was nothing but matrimony. But the number of questions was so huge that the organization called me again, ma'am, can we have a live-in relationship pe kuch?
Wow.
They were like, ma'am, live-in relationship pe kuch. Now, I couldn't have thought about it.
Mm-hmm.
Normally, because live-in relationships doesn't have a law around it, yes, we have Supreme Court judgments
mm-hmm.
about that they have the rights or whether domestic violence
given. But I think it's something new that people are, you know, curious to know what it is all about and how we can do it. The new India wants to know about it.
Exactly. The nation wants to know about it.
Right.
There are no laws about it.
Mm-hmm.
But then if the audiences wanted to know, then even I thought, okay, fine, why not?
Hmm.
So that gives me another perspective.
Right.
Then in that very webinar, somebody asked me about prenuptial agreements.
Right.
Not one person, but there were comments about it. So another point, because I think I've been telling people about prenuptial agreements since times immemorial, and a lot of time the clients or people are getting married and they know you and you say, do you know there are such agreements? And the person is like, I don't want to enter the marriage for thinking that it will break.
Right.
In India, we have that feeling, right?
Right?
So about that, I realized that maybe our generation, somebody till my generation doesn't believe in it, but the younger lot, the people who are younger than me, they are thinking about these.
Right.
So another thing that I got out of the social media interaction was, I got the local language, mein kehte hain, aap kisi cheez ki nafs pakad lete. You get what is the beat, you get what is the pulse of the audience that you are catering to.
Right.
Because those audiences can be only 2-3 things. Mm-hmm. Either they can be clients,
mm-hmm.
or they can be colleagues,
mm-hmm.
or they can be your next set of interns,
mm-hmm.
or associates.
Right.
So you know what the future generation thinks of. So you get a lot of, I think, social media interaction makes me grow as a lawyer.
Okay.
Where I give them whatever I know.
Mm-hmm.
Like, so I love disseminating knowledge. I do that. Mm-hmm. But then the questions they ask me are very good for me, are very good for my growth.
Right.
I love that about the social media interaction.
Mm-hmm.
And then comes about the jo dikhta hai, wo bikta hai.
Right.
One thing that as lawyers, hume cases bahut limited jagahon se aate hain.
Hmm.
Sabse pehle hume jagahon se aate hain apni khud ki family se.
Right.
वो केसेस होते हैं जिसमें आपको पता है, पहला वो आता है बेटा थोड़ी फीस का देख लेना वाला,
राइट।
उसके बाद आता है आपको आपके फ्रेंड सर्कल से या नोन लोगों से, और उसके बाद आपको आता है रेफरल से, कि आपने अपने एक हैप्पी क्लाइंट विल रेफर यू टू मल्टीपल मल्टीपल पीपल। तो अब ये सब तो हो गया, सोशल मीडिया से आपका क्लाइंट कन्वर्जन क्या रेफरल जितता है? नहीं। रेफरल जो होता है ना उसमें क्लाइंट आपके पास आपका फुल जिसे कहते हैं ना भरोसा करके आता है,
right?
Because the other person has told that client कि अगर इसके पास जाओगे मैं बच गया, तो आप भी बच सकते हो या आप बच जाओगे। हम बोलते हैं आप बच सकते हो, the client has already told कि आप तो बच जाओगे, बचोगे। So it is not as strong as referral, but then there are people who are seeing you, there are people who are noticing you. Mm-hmm. And there are people who for some extent start idolizing you. So aapko client to milta hai. Dekho, I have got clients, so I can say aisa nahi hai, clients nahi.
Right.
That was not my purpose of joining. Aate hai, aapke paas aate hai. Are they as strong as referrals? No.
No, of course.
Because wo alag baat hai, maybe when they'll start. अभी मे बी आफ्टर 10 months, 11 months, year, 2 years, then maybe they know how good you are. If you're consistent, so maybe. But अभी तक उतना रेफरल का तो बात ही अलग
है.
ये बताए आपका सोशल मीडिया क्लाइंट कैसा है? ये वैसा क्लाइंट है जिसने आपको लाइव कोर्ट में, जैसे कुछ क्लाइंट्स होते हैं ना, आप कोर्ट में आर्ग्यू कर रहे होते हो, वहां कोई बैठा सुन रहा होता है, और फिर वो बाहर आप कोर्ट के बाहर बोलता है वकील साहब मेरा केस ले लो, अपना कार्ड दे दो।
हाँ जी,
ये क्लाइंट वैसा है।
अच्छा,
ये क्लाइंट वो वाला क्लाइंट है जिसने आपको लाइव परफॉर्म करते देखा है।
अच्छा, राइट।
दिस इज दैट क्लाइंट, दिस इज माय
राइट। Also, ma'am, out of the lot of people who are practicing, when you see only like, let's say 10 lawyers online and they're talking to the people, they're actually directly connecting with the people, I think it is a lot of market. Because you see, you know, you might know a lot of lawyers, you might know like 100 of lawyers, you can go to any court and you can find them there. It's just that those 10 lawyers who are actually being in front of the audience, they're telling them, they're addressing their issues that they might have. Or maybe if you're talking about like, let's say matrimonial issues, then maybe if I have somebody in my family who is facing the same problem or something related to that, I would obviously like your name or your image will click in my mind and I'll suddenly refer them to you, that okay, this person is very easy to contact and that is why I'm giving. So I think social media, it has made a huge market there, but obviously there is a thing that we call the click through rate is very low. That whatever the amount of people who are actually going to come and give you money and say mera case kar do, those are going to be very less.
Yes, yes. And like you just said, ki aapke ghar mein koi case hoga to mera aapke dimag mein ekdam se click karega ki I heard so and so person.
Right.
Yes, so and so person was there.
Right.
But one thing you said is so and so person is very easy to approach.
Right.
That is not the factor you consider. What you consider is there is a, I think, huge amount of lawyers that we have. You enter any court premise and you realize ki wo law, I'm sorry for being a little, I'm not wanting to be disrespectful.
That's
but wo lawyers bhi hai jo aapko pakadte hai aur bolte hai ki, itte mein kar dunga.
Right. Yes, kar dunga.
Kar lo, hire kar dunga. Aur wo lawyers bhi hai, like Mr. Harish Salve. तो आपको, आप उनके पास जाते हो, सर प्लीज कितने करोड़ ले लो मेरे को बचा दो। लॉयर्स वी हैव, राइट? आप हरीश सालवे से ये नहीं कहोगे कि सर क्या बात कर रहे हो, थोड़ा सा कम कर लो।
नहीं,
यू नो हिज कैपेबिलिटी, यू नो ही गो इन हिज हैंड, यू आर सेफ। आई थिंक द सेम वे नाउ आई कैन बी प्रेजेंट ऑन सोशल मीडिया, ओके, I can speak my mind out. But the question is, am I effective?
Right.
Question is, I can be speaking, I can be addressing. But A, am I effective? B, am I adequate? And C, am I knowledgeable?
Right.
If you come and see my video or attend a seminar that I'm giving, or, you know, as law students, we had so many lectures in our colleges where top-notch judges used to come and speak, and we didn't listen to them carefully because we were playing with our friends sitting in the audience just because we thought we'll get one extra attendance or 10 extra attendances, or maybe the teacher bribed us with something just so that the audience is full, right?
So
what was important was, A, are you visible? That is only the first point. You can only get a platform. But are you knowledgeable enough? And if you're knowledgeable, a lot of people are knowledgeable, but are you able to express that and show the world that you are?
Right.
Are you effective? That is another very big point.
Right.
So social media can only be an easy platform. It cannot make you effective.
Right.
So the first thing that will come to your mind is not that the person is easily approachable. The first thing that will come to your mind is the person worth it?
Right.
If I have a matrimonial problem in my house, I hope this lawyer will not doom my relative.
Right.
So that is, I think, you have to have some substance.
Right. Because clients nowadays are also very smart. They can get every information available on the internet, and for their own issue, they study for weeks and months for that same issue. Yes. So they have a lot of knowledge. It's just that the application is supposed to be something that we are going to do, and we have to make them feel that we are worth it.
Well, there are times where my clients start sending me Supreme Court judgments and something. Then I have to put that contact on mute, that I don't want 10 judgments a day in my... And once I told them, you've hired me for a reason, okay? I know what I'm doing.
Right, Trust me. So, ma'am, also, since obviously we're reaching the end of the show because of the time constraints, but I am enjoying this conversation so much because of how ready you are to talk to me, and obviously the things you are sharing, how ambitious you are and how you love, like totally love your profession. It's really inspiring to see. So, ma'am, my last question for you today will be that, how do you deal with clients, and what is your personal way of how you deal with clients and how you, conduct yourself in front of them?
I think the best way to deal with the client is, in your head, you are thinking like a third person, third party approach, aerial view. And in front of the client, you are as emotionally available, emotionally attached as possible, especially when matters are there with the person's household is at risk, or where the person's life is at risk. Matrimonial and criminal matters, these two matters, I think, require the client to trust you. And trust can only come if you are all ears.
Right.
You know, the first thing I think you need is patience. I treat my clients with utmost patience, and I think with utmost respect. Because I understand that normally the thing is, we are always short of time. Always we are short of time, and we have something or the other to attend to.
Right.
But when I'm with the client, that half an hour, that 1 hour, sometimes even 1.5 hours, I'm with the client. I do not see my phone. I do not do anything else. I am totally with the client, totally attached, and I totally understand. One, that is one way. Think like give a third person's perspective in your head.
Right.
But if for the client, it should feel as if you are their family.
Right.
So they start opening up. And when they start emotionally opening up, then they actually tell you what the true story is. Because in the first instant, they're all guarded. You have to enter their, you have to break their wall of defense.
Right.
And you as a lawyer have to enter the client's heart. Sometimes, you know what you have to do? You have to do the same thing that the opposite counsel will do in the cross-examination. Break the client.
Okay.
But that person will do it with words. You have to do it with emotions.
Right.
You have to make the client realize. You know, there are some times when the client will tell you only his or her side of the version. Version of the story. they will tell you so and so person did this, so and so person that did that, he did that, she did that.
Mm.
And you will get a story which you know is not right.
Okay.
You know there's no stimuli. How is this reaction coming?
Hmm.
You understand it's a one-sided story. It's not a concocted story. Hmm. It's a one-sided story. Then okay. You have to make the client understand that I am not the court.
Hmm.
You don't have to lie in front of me.
Right.
Give me the entire story.
Hmm.
That is, I think, the toughest part of handling the client. Making the client open up about what he or she did. Because the problem is, we as humans have a tendency of forgetting our faults.
Right.
We don't do that intentionally. It is a defense mechanism.
Right.
You feel like if I say something to you and you respond, I would say react. You react.
Right.
I will always feel that she reacted.
Mm-hmm.
I will forget I said something.
Right.
And I'm not hiding this from my advocate.
Mm-hmm.
I have believed it in my mind that I didn't say anything to the other person.
Mm-hmm.
So I think breaking down the wall of defense of the client, sitting mm-hmm. with the client, giving time to the client and giving wholehearted, undivided attention to the client
right.
is extremely important. Because at the end, we are charging for our time.
Mm-hmm.
How can we charge for our time and not give it in totality to the client?
Right.
Hmm. So that is my first mantra. That if the client is sitting in front of me and even crying for half an hour straight, I will listen to that cry because somewhere my ear is waiting for that two lines that are important to me.
Right. Okay.
The client will just say, if the client is keep on nagging, I'm waiting for that only two lines. The rest I'm eliminating.
Right.
I am not listening. My brain is on the bird's eye.
Okay.
And first, and secondly, sometimes what happens is, and that happens predominantly in matrimonial issues, it is your client will come to you that I want maybe a divorce. And then it will keep on changing. Then someday it will be like, I want a criminal case also. And then someday it will be like, I want this also. And someday it will be like that. And in the end, there can be days when the client will say, I don't want anything. I just want to get out of the relationship.
Right.
So you have to, and then you have to get ready for everything. So that wastes your time. You spend time. So very recently something like this happened. Of course, I can't share the details. So this client of mine is a very sweet person. She apologized. She was like, I know I've wasted a lot of your time. I know I'm changing my decision. Finally, she wanted an easy way out. She wanted to go. Finally, she said, I want a mutual divorce. I don't want ugly litigations.
Okay.
Right. So, she said, I can't be happier. I told her, it is my job to give you what not you want, but what you need.
Right.
Because there are times where what we do as lawyers is, we think that court jana hamara farz hai. Because paise usi se aate.
Right.
So one more thing I do is I try to divide my cases into two categories. Is it worth the litigation? Is it not worth the litigation? Because I feel in the concept that there is no win-win.
Right.
It is a loss. So one more thing I do is I keep on, if I can, I see this is what the client wants from me. And then I will filter. Is it what the client needs?
Right.
That is also something I do. Of course, the client will in the end get what the client asked for. And I can only counsel or I can only advise.
Right.
But I keep that also in mind while handling the client. I keep filtering. That is. And the one thing that I told you, that client for that 1 hour is all there. That's all the world exists for me.
Right.
That is my world at that moment. Nothing else. So I think that is my client handling. And one more thing I do is I don't lie to the client.
Right.
I do not lie to the client. I always tell the client that 90% is, of course, is our case. 10% is the discretion of the court.
Right.
I will never tell the client, "Ji, jita denge aapko, aap tension mat karo." That's what happens. Right? I never do that.
Right.
Second, what I do is, there are two types of clients again. One are who totally trust you. They actually surrender and they are lovely people to work with. They surrender and they think that whatever you say is good for them.
Right.
So for those clients, so I will work 10 extra miles.
Okay.
Right. So one is handling those clients. Those clients, I will tell them, I will walk them through. Like this happens, I'll give them two options. This is the easier route. This is the more difficult route. This will achieve more. The more difficult route, maybe you can achieve some this or that. So I'll give them a step-by-step, step-by-step way. And then I tell them to decide that this will be the expense and the time involved. Do you want to go for it? That I do for those clients. And then there are clients who think they're better than you. Who think they know everything because they have consulted Google Baba. Advocate Google is like the best advocate in the world.
Right.
And YouTube has become the world of advocates. By the way, even I'm thinking of joining that actually.
Why not, ma'am? I would love to help you. I can make your channel and everything. We can work on that.
I was actually thinking of doing it because I thought that I'll reach so many more people. I can help and educate so many more people.
Right.
So yeah. Ma'am. Yeah, so they have YouTube, they learn from that and Google. So they will come to you with solution and they will want you to listen to their solution.
Right.
You have two ways to handle such clients. One, you have to see if that client doesn't want to listen to you, you have to let go also sometimes. There is a time, there is this borderline case that you have to let go also.
Okay.
But there are some of them who are maneuverable. You have to, I can be the sweetest and the harshest person depending on how you approach me. There are clients who I will not like give two extra minutes to.
Right.
Like, this is your time, you paid for this, okay, bye bye. Because they are those tough clients. Right. And there are clients sometimes I'd pick their phones up at 11 p.m. Because I know these people need me. Like today's a Sunday. I have been handling clients since morning. And Sunday is my client meeting day.
Right.
It's my client meeting day so that I don't have to worry about the court and everything and I can give them uninterrupted time.
Right, exactly.
Handling client is, honestly, if you ask me, the biggest challenge in advocacy.
Right.
You can learn the procedures of the code. You can read the law. The entire law is codified. Law is no rocket science. You have barracks, then you have commentaries, then you have a lot of books involved. So law is totally codified. Law is written. Then the procedure, so you work for 1 year, 2 year, 3 year, 4 year, you know what the procedure is all about. I think two things actually, which a lot of people should know if you especially want to have your own practice. Corporate law and all is different.
Right.
If you want to have your own practice, you need to have two things. One is social skills.
Right.
Emotional skills, which we say, you know, you have to have that emotional connect with the person. Otherwise, why should I trust you with my case?
Right.
It's my life that we are talking of.
Right.
Cannot trust anybody who doesn't understand and who I think is not understanding my case. Sometimes a lot of people think ki vakil saab samajh hi nahi rahe hamari baat. That is what the polarity is. And secondly, you need to have business skills. Because running a private practice, I kid you not, is running a business.
Right.
Getting clients is our job. Handling operations is our job. Sometimes there are times when your clerk and your office boy have a fight.
Right.
And the clerk is in charge of the office boy. So the hierarchy breaks and the office boy comes to you like, why did you go to that person? Why are you breaking my office's hierarchy? So there are times you have administrative functions also.
Right.
And at the end, you are already working as a lawyer. So I think if you want to have your own business practice, you have to have these skills, managerial skills and social skills.
Right.
I don't think without either of these, you can become an independent practitioner.
Right.
So you have a basic requirement.
Right. Okay, so ma'am, thank you so much for your time. I think I've taken a lot of your time here, but thank you so much for coming on the show and actually enlightening all of us with all the, and also the way you talk and the way you have, I think you have kept everybody engaged here, and so thank you so much for coming on the show, ma'am. Everybody check out the Logairs YouTube channel. You can check out ma'am's details in the description down below, and please subscribe to the channel, and see you next time.